Welcome to the Endless Knot Podcast,
where the more we know,
the more we want to find out,
tracing serendipitous connections through our lives
and across disciplines.
Hi, I'm Avon.
And I'm Mark.
And today we have a special podcast episode for you all the way from Anaheim, California.
Woohoo! We've just returned from EduCon and VidCon. While we were there, we took the opportunity to record a few little podcast bits with some of our fellow EduTube creators.
So we spoke to Cynical Historian, Knowing Better. We spoke to the 12-Tone team and the Step Back History team. And so we sort of about half an hour conversation with each of them about why they make their channels, what their channels are about, some of their journey towards what they do now, and general rants. And we also talked a little bit about
what they thought about VidCon and EduCon and their experience.
And for those that don't know, VidCon is a very large convention, really, not a conference so much, convention put on every year. This was the 10th anniversary, in fact, started by the Green Brothers, but it is now owned by Viacom. And it is for anyone who does online creation, but it really centers around video creation in particular.
And EduCon is a sort of parallel event that happens just before VidCon, and it's run by YouTube and the We Create EDU group, and it's specifically focused on educational creators.
It's run, some version of it has happened the last 4 years, including this year. Last year and this year were the first years that YouTube was strongly involved. Mm-hmm. And we went last year and this is our second year going. So just to give you a little background when we mention these events and we talk about them, but we talk about them in some detail in the interviews. So without any further ado, I think we can just go straight to them. The one thing I will say is that we recorded these in hotel rooms, basically. Yeah. So, you know, there's some background noise. I think the hotel fridge turns on once or twice. It's Anaheim. There's some sirens outside and things like that.
And occasionally, possibly large rumbling noises of fancy sports cars outside.
Yes.
Because it's California.
But it's all perfectly listenable, but apologies for a little bit of background noise. So I hope you'll enjoy, and we'll be back next month with another episode. So, welcome, Cypher. Thanks for being on the podcast.
Hi-o. So, for those of you who don't know, Cypher here makes the Cynical Historian YouTube channel.
Mm-hmm. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the channel to start off?
So I make analytical history videos, sometimes do movie reviews. That seems to be the more popular thing. But then, you know, I sprinkle it in with just random history stuff that I can put a little bit of a scholarly spin on it.
Are there, she asks as if she doesn't know, are there any particular areas of history that you are most interested in?
Well, of course, there's pop stuff that, you know, I kind of get exposed to just because of movies, but professionally, I study the American West and specifically American violence. I also like to look into the history of where I live and try to expand the definition of public history.
Well, and I also want to sort of draw our listeners' attention to the fact that you have done etymology videos and cocktail.
Yeah. Although those are the worst performing videos on the channel.
Well, maybe we can fix that. I think we might have the audience for you.
I literally just had a comment like 2 days ago, like, why haven't you done another one of these? And it's like, did you see the view counts?
But the people who like that stuff are the best people, right, audience?
I love that stuff. It's like mixing two things that are just, well, I mean, like, etymology is everywhere, right? And I mean, it's literally what we speak, but, like, drinking's also fun.
I'm on board with that. So, what you're saying is we can't be guaranteed there will be any more of those videos in the future, but if we just watch every video you put out, one of them might be about etymology.
I sometimes do try to sneak in, like, little tidbits of etymology in sometimes, because, like, the other thing is, etymology videos on my channel just don't perform well. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Perhaps I titled it wrong because I'll call it like engaging etymology, and it's like, you know, so many people don't even know what etymology is.
Right. Yeah, under that name, yeah.
And it's like, maybe they see it and go like, who cares what miasma and what?
But I mean, when you talked about filibuster and freebooting, that was like really historically grounded, that one.
Oh yeah, that's the one I should have recommended.
To the video audience.
Yeah, because, man, I do a lot of stuff with filibustering. The funny thing is there's sometimes where, you know, you're so rooted in that stuff, you're researching it constantly, that you forget that there's like this whole political thing with filibustering that, yeah, like people stand on the Senate floor and it's like, no, I'm talking about people trying to steal Mexico. And it's so weird because sometimes people will comment, I'll throw in something about filibusters because I've done a lot of research on filibusters. And, you know, like, I did a review of Walker, for instance, and, you know, he filibustered into this thing, and then, like, comments will be like, the heck does that have to do with the Senate?
Yeah, it hasn't quite got to the point yet in the Senate that the filibuster actually involves, like, mercenaries and...
Well, there's an interesting connection there, because the reason why filibustering became a term in the Senate is directly related to actual military filibustering. I call it actual filibustering. The Senate's just pretending.
That are the metaphorical filibusters. Yeah. These were the...
Well, I mean, it's rooted in freebooter, which, you know, stealing and all that. But, like, it's because there's, because one of the senators was being penalized for trying to filibuster Cuba. And then, during that, he came up and just started talking and talking and talking. And finally, people started leaving for the day. And, like, it was a known tactic by the 1850s, but it didn't have a name yet.
Right, yes.
And suddenly, it's like, well, filibustering is like pirating land, so now you're just trying to pirate the Senate.
Right.
And that's kind of where, that's the connect, it's a direct connection.
Right, cool.
When was the last time someone's done a filibuster in, like, the political filibuster?
A military one?
No, a political one. A Senate one.
I mean, well, there's multiple types where you threaten to filibuster.
Yeah,
and,
right.
Most famously recently was Rand Paul, but that was like 4 years ago. And there was somebody who did it very recently. I mean, like a couple months ago.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But like it happens all the time.
Mm. But yeah, it doesn't necessarily go for days and days, days and days, right? Yeah. You just have to sort of go out the session.
Strom Thurmond is the longest single person filibuster, and he went for like 25 hours.
Yeah.
25 hours.
Wow. And as a single dude. Of course, that sounds impressive, but you know what he was filibustering? The Civil Rights Act.
Oh, yeah, no. No way that Strom Thurmond was doing something that I approve of. Of course. Actually, know that, yeah.
You know something interesting, though, on the history of filibusters, and that, you know, the last military one from the United States?
When? More recently? I don't know.
Yeah, very recently.
Okay.
There was an attempted filibuster into Gambia in 2014.
2014? Whoa. Who was behind it?
It was basically, they were trying to basically do a coup and you know, take over, and as filibusters do, they were trying to mock it up as like, oh, no, we're really one of the people, even though we're born in America. Well, two out of the three were born in America. One was from Gambia. But, you know, they were like literally trying to gather arms and all that kind of stuff. You know,
and they were just sort of random people. They weren't like tied to any particular group or anything?
Well, they were tied to a rebellious group in the Gambia, but, like, they were... One of them was an expat because of that.
Okay.
And that's how the whole thing was organized. Luckily, the U.S. actually did something about it this time and stopped it from ever happening. And they were prosecuted under this... Well, I mean, it was big news because they were prosecuted under the 1794 Neutrality Act.
Oh, cool.
The thing that all these other filibusters should have been
Right.
Prosecuted. Well, William Walker was actually prosecuted under it, but, you know, California seemed to like filibusters at that point.
Mm. Right. Interesting. Well, I certainly didn't hear about that. I deliberately don't listen to a lot of news, so that might be why.
And the amount of American news that we get in Canada is, you know,
we get very specific American news.
Yeah. Also, filibusters are one of those things that, like, you know, it seems like it's old hat, but, you know, it's that it's merely old hat because the U.S. is now actually trying to enforce its own laws.
Right.
But, like, you know, it actually happens regularly. People just come up with a scheme to take over another country, and it's like, yeah, that's filibustering.
Right. It just doesn't always succeed, or often doesn't succeed.
Well, I can name all the successful filibusters on one finger.
Touche.
West Florida. That's
right.
Oh, wait. No, you guys have a successful one. But,
oh, yeah?
Yeah. One of the islands.
Oh, okay.
Took it from Sweden.
Oh, so in the Arctic somewhere.
Yeah, Arctic Island. Okay. Wow.
That can't have been in the bloodiest of battles.
No, there was, like, 3 shots fired, and it was, like, it was basically the same thing that happened between us, the U.S. and Canada in 1854 with the whole pig thing, where it's like, we fired shots at each other, it's a war, and it's like...
You know, both countries have had some wars. Maybe we can raise the bar a little on this.
but it was the island one, that was 1920s, and it was like some fishermen who just decided to, you know, take over an island that was unoccupied, but then the Swedish, you know, patrol came by and was like, hey, they're like, we have handguns, bang bang. And it's like, and there's apparently one that an island that still is like.
Yes, I was gonna say that every time they go by, it's between them and is it Sweden or Norway? I feel like it might be Norway.
I might be mixing up.
The Scandinavian countries. Yeah. Sorry, Scandinavian countries. But it might be Denmark. That's the one. There's one. Yes, and every time the Canadian patrol go by, they put a Canadian flag and a bottle of whiskey.
Yeah.
And then every time the Danes come by, they put a bottle of vodka and a flag. Who knows? But it's like an uninhabited.
Yeah,
no one really.
It's a little tiny island, but it's just the fact that there's a flag on it.
Yeah. So now it counts as on one side or the other at the border. Yeah. So why did, so as you said, you're doing professionally, as in school, you're studying, and you're studying for a PhD.
Mm-hmm.
Why did you start doing YouTube?
I'm kind of on a dare. So I was complaining that there just weren't any, history, there wasn't any history content. And
this is back in the day.
Oh yeah. This was 2013 when I started. There was, but most of it was like teacher oriented and that kind of stuff. I mean, you guys hadn't even started yet.
No.
I mean, it's really diversified now. Unfortunately, not in terms of types of voices, but you know, at that point, it was basically you had like Crash Course, CGP Grey, teacher, you know, basically Crash Course, but like Tom Ritchie kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
And so I wanted, you know, like, they're SciShow, and they sometimes, like, get into analysis and deal with the problems and everything, and it's like, why can't we have that for history? And I kept complaining about that and complaining about that, and my friends are just like, well, then you do it. And I'm like, fine.
What do you think the balance is now, anyways, on YouTube in terms of sort of just straight narrative history versus more analytical history?
Heavily on the narrative side.
Yeah.
And in terms, I mean, YouTube's, or any kind of media like this, is going to be pop history.
Right.
It's going to be the most prevalent kind. And with pop history, you tend to get more narrative. And, you know, that's just, like, that's what sells, yes, but it's also much more entertaining. So that's why it sells.
Yeah, they're good stories.
Yeah.
I mean, why do so many people like history? A lot of people like history because it has great stories.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like that on
It's
on
very much like that podcasts, in podcasts,
too.
Yeah.
It's very heavily on the narrative.
We had this conversation with Mike Duncan from History of Rome on our podcast, because he, you know, does narrative history. And we had that discussion about, like, you know, are there drawbacks to narrative history? And I mean, I think there are. But he said, listen, that's what people want to hear. And if that, you know, you can put in some analytical stuff as you do the narrative.
Yeah.
You can discuss causes and consequences and do some thematic stuff along the way. But if you don't have that structure of stories, people don't come to you. And, well, I mean, I don't think that's...
always
inevitable, but
you have, or when, I mean, it's not history if it's purely analysis,
right?
Like, there has to be a narrative that's always going to be there. It's just analytical history means that you're emphasizing something else over the narrative.
You're using the narrative as like the base from which you then do other stuff.
Because if you're not bothering to connect the dots, that's not history. You're a chronicler.
Yeah.
You know, you're just saying this happened, then this happened, then this happened. You're not talking about why. You're not talking about cause and effect. You're not...
consequences. Yeah. What it tells us about people. Yeah, yeah.
You know, the stock and trade of historians is the connective tissue, right? We always have to have some sort of narrative, but it's, you know, it's just a question of how much. And narrative historians or narrative pop history, because, you know, there's a lot of them that aren't really historians. But, you know, every man's a historian, I guess. I like Carl Becker. But the fact is that it's also really hard to get people to like the analytical side of things, because that's where you get into the kind of dirty stuff, you know, that you get into the controversy, and you get into things that, like, don't easily make people happy.
Right.
And people have to think about, and it starts to sort of implicate other people. Like, analytical history makes you have to think about, well, how does that affect the way I live my life, or the choices I make, or how would my choices be different than those choices, or how, and all of those things, and that they can be, and that can be disquieting.
And it's also, I mean, like, that's one of the powers of etymology, for instance, is like that, like, you know, let's think about how this history is built into our language. And it's like, you don't have a choice in so much of the words that you use, and yet some of them have, like, this really dark history to them. And while I study American violence, so I like going into the dark stuff, but, like, that's disquieting to a lot of people. And it's like, my videos often are fairly controversial, even with my audience, because you have to be. Otherwise, it's not analytical history.
Do you ever get pushback from your audience that you're doing too much analysis and not enough narrative?
No, but I think that's also part of, like, how I hate to use the term market myself.
Well, it's a self-selecting audience, right? They know what they're getting.
Yeah.
You don't make any bones about it. You're not pulling them in with the promise of a narrative and then, like, springing analysis on them.
Because, like, I mean, even with the movie reviews, I make sure to include basically a historiography section. I just call it scholarship. I do try to simplify some of these
terms.
Yeah,
you don't need to use the sort of jargon, because...
Well, I still use the word all the time, because I can't help myself.
Yeah.
But, like, in terms of the title card, it literally just says scholarship. But most of the time, that's, like, a discussion of historiography. And, like, and I often try to... Like, I just put out one today that was on Mary, Queen of Scots, and it was, like, talking about more of the myth surrounding her. And how it evolved, how it's changed, you know, how, like, and of course you have to be very, very quick with that. It's like 3 minutes of historiography, which comes out to, like, a paragraph. No, that's more like three paragraphs. But still, you know, a historiography section in a book should be, like, a half a chapter at least, you know? And if you're doing it in an article, it should be... I mean, you could do it in a paragraph, but that's going to be a heck of a paragraph, and your footnotes are going to be gigantic.
Silly Chicago footnotes.
Hey, well, that's...
We don't need to get into that again. This is the kind of exciting pub discussions that we have around here.
Which
footnote style is awful, and which one is great.
If you want to understand that, look up Onion Chicago versus APA.
And the knives came out.
Because they make it into a gang war, and they're not far off.
No, they really aren't. The emotion assumption's totally there.
Yeah. I get in my mom's a sociologist, so we get into arguments on this. And my dad's a historian, so...
So there's like it's unfair like, ganging up here.
Well, it's like us in the pronunciation of Latin.
Yeah. Medieval versus ancient, it's a thing. So the reason we're all sitting here together in our hotel room, and apologies for, I noticed there was a very noisy engine that went by a little earlier, and I think the fridge turned on, but anyway, sorry for the sound quality.
Or slamming doors.
Or slamming doors. is that we're all in Anaheim for VidCon, and yesterday, as of this recording, we were at EduCon in LA, which YouTube ran in their YouTube space there. So, how did you enjoy EduCon?
EduCon is significantly better than VidCon.
Yes.
Without a doubt.
And yeah, it was
while
pretty awesome.
Google has been kind of asserting themselves more and more on this, especially compared to last year, where it's just like, okay, we're shoving you all in a conference area in the Hilton and just like, have at it.
Yeah, they gave us money last year, but they didn't do much of the organization. Yeah.
This year they were like, okay, we're going to have a rigid structure. They're really pushing that whole... you know, school thing,
theme.
Like,
theme.
There was, like, school bells, and we got, like, lunch pails. very silly, but also, like, they started pushing more of, like, a rigid structure. Mm-hmm. A lot of the panels got kind of corporatized and that. And while I absolutely love EduCon, I liked the previous one far better.
Right.
Because it was much more informal, and we had more control, and there was less, like, I think you were in the Business 201 one,
no,
right?
No, because we were running Business 101.
Oh, yeah, you
but
too.
To be fair, the fact that they called that panel, which we ran with someone else, and we wanted it to be about, like, how do you integrate, you know, academics and YouTube, or how do you academic do a career? The fact they called that Business 101, we were like, that's not, I mean, it was fine, but it was not... That wasn't our title, right?
No,
like,
but it was and, you know, the business of a YouTuber, so...
Yeah, so... Yeah.
It's a recognition that...
If it had been called, like, scholarship and YouTube, I would have gone to that.
Yeah, right.
Because I saw Business 101, and I didn't see that you guys were running it, otherwise I would have been like that one. But, like, I saw the other one was talking about, like, hiring, and I'm actually, like, thinking about hiring an editor. Mm-hmm. You know, like, keep this on the low down, even though this is a podcast. but I'm thinking about it, and so I figured I'd go to a panel about it. And, you know, they have us all raise hands, like, you know, who is editing their own videos? And it's like the entire room. And it's like, who's thinking about hiring an editor? And then it's like the entire room.
Yeah,
and,
right.
And then it's like, okay, so we're going to talk about, like, setting up a 15-person business with multiple editors, script writers, separate hosts and everything, and we're just sitting like, I just want to hire, like, one dude.
It's a big gap there between, the small creator who maybe wants to start putting together a small team or even one guy, but and then those huge kind of more corporatized channels that...
Mm. And when we say small creator, not all those... I mean, they're small... relatively, but not all of the one-person teams
are small
in terms of subscribers or small in terms of view counts. They have,
like Vsauce.
Well, Vsauce is definitely
a team. He's a definite team.
He actually, like, didn't have his hand up when they asked, so.
Well, now, but, I mean, it started off as just...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, but I also mean that right now.
Yeah.
I mean, not that, like, multi-million subscriber channels, sure, but, like, you or Will or...
There was one... person in there that did raise their hand that was multi-million.
Mm. Yeah.
So two that I could point out, but I don't want to name names.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how much of that stuff people wanted out. So yeah, but I do think, like, there are small, as in small team creators who are not necessarily small in terms of views. And it is a bit tough for YouTube or for anybody to try to, like, they want to have those bigger creators and those teams in the room. And at EduCon, and I do think it's really useful to us to have them there because
but it's
for
also,
the contact meeting. But in terms of the sessions, they aren't as they don't need the help the same way we do.
They kept on redirecting questions to, like, the big stuff too, and it was like,
That's too bad.
I just want to know about hiring an editor. Like, what's good ways of doing this? What should I expect in terms of that? And what percentage of, of money and
right, like some of the details. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because this needs to be something for that in between.
Yeah, and that's what I thought. Like,
that would be.
It's literally called Business 201. Mm-hmm. So like.
Yeah.
And the other one, they did you guys injustice there, because like the way it was worded, it was like. Do you want to have a good way of, like, putting together things? It's like, I've been doing this for, 6 years now? I think I've got a bit of a clue on that.
Yeah, no, I it was fine. We had, I don't know, 20 people in the room and maybe 15. But, you know, we had a good discussion with the people who were there. I think
it was a good panel. As it turned out, a lot of them were education, like, people who were academics, in academics somehow.
It's a surprising, like, while the history space, especially when... Like, Tristan had a graduate degree in it.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of other ones, there's a lot of folks who are working with, like, just a bachelor's or even less in the history space.
Yeah, or have a degree but not in history or whatever.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Yeah.
But history is one of the few ones that are really open in terms of non-professionals.
Yeah, aficionados, amateurs, whatever you want to say. People who are... interest. Well, I mean, that's one of the things that's very, really interesting in podcasting too, that we continually want to have. I mean, the panel became something else partly because another person was added to it, and I think it was fine and it worked well, but like, my impulse is always to talk very specifically about like, why aren't academics doing these things?
Yeah.
How can we support those academics to do those things? How can we make the case that they should? And then also, it's not the only, like, it's not that only academics can make good video. I don't even mean that in the slightest.
No.
But
a lot of academics can't make good things videos at all, to save the lives.
Or good podcasts. But I mean, I think there are people who could, who don't, because... But now, one of the things is, in some ways, maybe that discussion doesn't make sense to have that discussion at EduCon, because the people in the room there can't change the academic structure and already are convinced to do it. So, you know,
but there's also but one of the things is figuring out... we can do together to try to advance that. I mean, we talked about this panel that I'm trying to put together.
At conferences,
And conferences, and I think if we kind of like restructuring HNET for around these kinds of things. And, like, these are institutional-level... devices that we need YouTubers to be behind.
Yeah.
So that's what we can discuss there. But, like, things like, why don't they like us?
Yeah.
It doesn't really help.
No, I know there's a lot of grad, not so much in the history, but in, like, on the science side, there's a lot of grad students doing these YouTube videos right now, right? Like, just in the week reading EDU, there's a lot of people who are grad students at the moment.
Just not in terms of history.
No, not in terms of history, but in the sciences in particular, and some other fields, but... They were a lot of grad students, and I really, like, I think we had a bit of that conversation and a useful part, but, like, I really feel like we need to have a conversation with them about how can you keep this on your radar and make this, like, a selling point when you're going for a job, or how do we help brainstorm those, like, what does the CV look like, what do you do, can we write letters, can we, like, are there helpful...
It is a deeply concerning thing, because as a graduate student who is going to be in the job field in, like, 2 years...
Yeah, you want to be able to sell, that you want this to help sell you, you don't want it to be a weight around your neck, and it's sort of a 50-50 at, like, the moment.
I remember at the National Council on Public History a couple of years ago, I was debating this very thing, and, like, there were people who were literally saying, like, maybe you should just, like, disable the channel when you're on the job search. Yeah. But then again, they're also saying, like, well, maybe we shouldn't advertise that we have PhDs and just say that we have masters. It's like, What?
I don't think that's a thing. And I mean, you know, partly it's, you know, your channel, because it has more controversial topics, I suppose... That's a separate or extra level, but I don't know if that's really a big deal.
They're not... the controversy that I get into isn't controversial for academia.
Right, right. They know that it's...
You know, these are things that are
accepted,
like...
Accepted things.
Yeah. I mean, like, they may be controversial to individual academics, but the subject itself is
and
the fact that I'm
thing,
engaging
yes,
it is not controversial.
Right, right, right.
There are
sides to the... interpretive
and
discussion, but
there's actually a lot of times on the channel where I'm coming from an academic perspective, so I'm like, oh geez, this is gonna be the real tough part, and then it turns out to be a totally different piece that I'm like,
No, that's the one, we have the consensus on that one. We're good with that one. It was this part that I thought, like, people were going to take sides on. Yeah. But that's an academic side taking.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Well, yeah, I did enjoy EduCon a lot this year, but I know what you mean, and I think I'm still kind of trying to decide whether I, like, how, if I feel like it wasn't as good, or if I just feel like it was different. Mm. I'm sort of on the fence at the moment. I haven't processed it. It was a lot.
Yeah.
It was a big, long day, and there was a lot going on.
Yeah. Having more just physical space, I think, helped, because it was easier to mingle.
Yeah. Well, actually, I kind of feel the opposite on that.
Oh, yeah?
Because the fact that we were forced to be in a tiny little space last time.
Right.
There were constant... I mean, like, I talked to more people last time than I did this time. Mm. And there was plenty of times where it was like... Like, for instance, Hank Green. Mm. You know, big guy. Like, not...
Big name in our field. Yes.
Lots of subscribers. Not,
yeah. Important in our field. For sure.
Last time, I had multiple conversations with the dude, had like some like really meaningful ones that was like about like demonetization, hateful comments, all that kind of stuff in the forum, and yet continued it outside the classroom as we had nowhere else to go.
Mm. They certainly fed us well.
Oh god, yeah. That was great.
The dinner in particular.
Although I just wish the buses had just taken a little bit longer
to get there. I know. No, I wish we had...
I gotta get some wine and take it on the bus.
The one thing I wish we had was, in fact, longer. I wish the night before that party that had been, you know, had been supposed to go to 11. Like, I wish that it had gone later.
That the whole thing.
Well, I mean, partly I sort of feel like that, like...
There needs to be more...
Maybe... But it's hard to... I mean, maybe it should be 3 days long, like VidCon, and we should just do that instead of VidCon, frankly, that would be
much better, because, I mean...
VidCon is good because we're all here, and that's the only good part of it, as far as I'm concerned.
Like, for you listeners, we're all just going to go get dinner after this.
Yeah. That's going to be the best part of VidCon, dinner every night.
But that's how academic conferences are, too. Yeah, I mean, exactly. You're going to go and see, you're going to go and hear, like, the newest research that's happening.
You are going to learn things, and it is good, but it's the going to dinner that's the best.
Yeah, it's the, okay, we're done with the conference portion. Everybody shuffle down to the bar and start drinking.
And then you tell the crazy stories about what happened in your department.
And also you actually do, at least at academic conferences I've been to, you do sometimes sit and talk about research and stuff.
Or a book idea that you might have, or I really want to edit a collection of this.
And, or I'm teaching this class and I don't know what reading to use. Yeah. And those things do happen in those conversational spaces.
As a graduate student, you know, it's not just meeting people, it's like people telling you, like, you know, you're thinking about things, and then they're like, yeah, well, if you're doing that, well, how about this? And
give me those ideas. Yeah. And I heard you talk, and, you know, I wondered if you'd read, and, you know, that kind of stuff. Yeah.
And, like that's, like, the most valuable part of a conference isn't the conference itself. Mm-hmm. It's
putting everybody in the space together. Yeah. Speaking of dinner... Maybe we should wrap up and head out there. But thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah,
it was great to chat.
That's great.
And back soon with someone else. Thanks. Hi. Thanks for being on the podcast. And we wanted to start by, why don't you let us know what your channel is? I mean, we know, but let our fair listeners know about your channel and what kind of videos you make.
So my channel is called Knowing Better. And I do history, government, and psychology, mostly. I usually focus on topics that people know a little bit about, or even think they know a lot about, but I deep dive into the topic to kind of explain it more, and maybe the origins of certain ideas they have, and definitions of words they may have come across that they hadn't known before.
What are some of the, you know, more recent videos that you've made that kind of, what have you been recently investigating?
So I just finished up a pair of videos on feminism and men's rights.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Discussing those for a predominantly male audience.
So poking the bear, basically.
A little, yeah, you know, I wanted to explain feminism to men.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, the reaction was, well, what about men's rights? So I did a video on that, explaining when they are valid issues and when they are just a whataboutism.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
just an argument for the sake of saying we have it bad too.
Of deflecting the original argument.
Yeah. And I also just did a pair of videos on Dante and his Divine Comedy and Paradise Lost, talking about how a lot of Christian mythology actually comes from these works of fiction 1,300 years after the fact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, and I like the way you crowdsourced your stuff on this. Like, so every so often your Twitter will have, yes, okay, who gave, you know, who tempted Eve to get, yes, eaten an apple? Or
yeah, I do that to make sure, because I think my audience is fairly smart,
mm-hmm,
and they are, but they also believe the common myths.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It was an apple,
mm-hmm,
or...
it was Moses who turned his rod into a snake.
Yeah. And that's what I expected. I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to trick him.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to make sure that my audience believed what most people believe.
Yeah, and you wanted to make sure that what you thought most people believed was indeed what they still do.
Yes, yeah.
Because every so often, you never know, there might be like one pop culture thing comes along and changes what particular sort of,
or my
is,
entire,
yeah,
audience knows that it's not an apple,
right,
or whatever, and
right,
so then I'll know, okay, maybe I shouldn't.
Well, I'll leave that one out.
That.
Yeah,
yeah.
I always, they entertain me, and of course, I'm exactly the sort of person who's like, well, it was Aaron.
It was surprising how few people knew that.
Yeah, that one is. I mean, Aaron's role in that whole thing is never, no representation of it ever has him doing any of that.
Yeah. I watched several movies about the Book of Exodus in preparation for that, and at best he's like a side character. In the actual book, he's like
the
one who says everything. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's literally the speaker because Moses can't speak.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. I know, it's very strange. And he's the one, the one place people know about him is the golden calf, because he's the one who does the golden calf, Aaron is.
When Moses is up on the
he's the one who reluctantly is forced to create the golden calf by the people, I think, if I'm remembering right. Like, but nobody talks about him until then. Anyway, yeah, those were, I enjoyed those deep dives into biblical.
Well, good.
And literature, obviously something I enjoy.
But your moderate guide videos, I guess, are quite popular amongst your videos, right?
They are, yeah. So I've done a few. I started with gun control.
Right, so this is a moderate's guide to...
Yeah, I called the series A Moderate's Guide to, and gun control, immigration,
mm-hmm,
welfare,
mm-hmm,
and for those, it's very simple. I just start with, I want to know the answers to these questions. What is the difference between an assault rifle and an assault weapon?
Mm-hmm.
Because several gun people, gun nuts, will tell you those are made up. Those,
mm-hmm,
are made up terms when they're not. They're legal terms.
Right.
They've been banned, so, well, in certain cases, so they have to have legal terms. And immigration, what are the different visas? What is the visa lottery? That was a big one at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Our president was talking about getting rid of it, so I was like, well, what is it actually?
Mm-hmm.
So going into these videos, I don't know the answer.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking into it, and then I feel an obligation to tell other people what it is.
Right. Especially with all these topics, that there is so much misinformation or confusion or like media discussion with slippery terms or, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, when it comes to the visa lottery, it's often portrayed in the news even that we just let a bunch of Mexicans in,
mm-hmm,
when Mexico is actually one of the countries that's not allowed in the visa lottery.
Right, so this just shouldn't be part of that conversation.
Yeah.
You can have that conversation.
When
but...
I found that out, I was blown away.
Right.
Because I'm like, the visa lottery, for your viewers or listeners, it's enforced diversity. So it on purpose picks from countries that hadn't sent people in any other route.
Right.
So it's like the weirdest countries you'd never think of that are allowed into the visa lottery, like Liechtenstein and Estonia, like not the countries that most people are, quote, worried about.
Right, because there are other avenues for people from those countries to come in. There's other visas and other...
So getting rid of the visa lottery
would get, make would no get difference.
Away, it would, it's like 0.5% of our immigration in the U.S.
And not to put too fine a point on it, but it isn't the kind of people, I'm doing air quotes, you can't see that, the kind of people that the government, that Trump or whatever, are trying to foment concern about. Yes. It wouldn't help that at all.
So finding that stuff out and telling people and deep diving into welfare, what are the different systems, because that, again, even in the U.S., people just think there is a, quote, welfare. There's just the one, you go to the post office or whatever, and you get your welfare. Check. And no, there's like 15 overlapping systems
Programs and
all of that. So I enjoy those, because I also, I just tell you what it is. I don't say we should get rid of this. I do say, like, some people think we should combine these two or whatever, but I don't inject my own opinion, which is why I call it a moderate's guide, though some people disagree and say that because I didn't say that we should close everything down, I must be on the political left or something.
Right. So. Do you, just out of curiosity, do you get more attacks for not for being a lefty, or more attacks for being, like, not saying we should, you know, open all the board and not for being too right wing, or does it kind of
I get it from both sides. I get both sides, though I will say it's probably like a 2-to-1 ratio from the right. So more people on the right will say, "Oh, you're a communist, you're a whatever," because you talked about gun control without saying it's a bad idea.
Because it came from Satan,
But then I also get it from the left, where you know, I'm not a communist, so
you're not a communist.
People from the left are like, they get mad at me also for not saying that
all guns should be banned or whatever.
So I am, you know, I'm not a centrist, but I am a more moderate leftist. So that's
fine. And that's and that's reflected in. Do you think? Well, we don't have to go down this road necessarily, but I just wonder if, like, if that reflects your position, or if it reflects the, as it were, commenting habits of the internet more. Are right wingers more likely to go after you?
Oh yeah, that,
do you think?
Yeah,
yeah. Because I sort of feel like there's a fair chunk. It's not that there aren't leftist trolls. Like, don't get me wrong, there are. But I feel like there's a fair chunk of people who are sort of on the left who are like, I don't like that, and I'm moving on.
Yeah.
Rather than, I don't like that, now my life's goal is to make this guy know I don't like it.
It's somewhat important also to distinguish. In America, I am a left.
Yes.
I'm left.
Right. But yes.
When it comes to, you know, European and possibly even Canada, I am probably what you would consider a centrist.
Yeah, no, the spectrum in the U.S. is
shifted
from from not everywhere else by any means, but from a lot, and from Canada. There's some creep going on in Canada right now, but some of the things that are just so fundamental to Canadian politics that so far haven't been completely attacked are positions that are really far left in the U.S., like, you know, healthcare and certain kinds of education policies and, you know, things like that. So until those things are eroded and destroyed, the mainline is always going to be a bit left of the U.S., I think. So we'll see. I'm feeling a little pessimistic about this fall's election, I've got to say.
Oh, you have one coming up?
We have coming up in the fall. We have a federal election. And
Trudeau has messed a bunch of things up.
Yeah, so though I feel like he may have messed them up early enough. I feel like maybe he'll be able to come back. I don't know. The right wing party is the leader of the right wing party right now is trying to be Trump light. Like, he's really, and that worked in Ontario. We elected a piece of crap who's definitely took the Trump playbook, especially the part that was like, I don't need to have a platform
or
a plan. I can just say people are bad a lot, and then they'll elect me. And it worked.
Cheap beer.
And cheap beer.
Elect me, and I'll give you cheap beer.
He was big into cheap beer.
Really?
Yeah.
That's like one of those student council promises.
Yes.
And it was totally. $1 beer. Buck a beer. That was his slogan. So
wow.
That was it. Like, and you understand, before that, there was Buck a beer. Like, there were $1 beers, but he was like going to take the tax off or something.
Yeah.
He was going to bring more. And he was bringing it down from like $1.10 to $1, right? Like, it's not like it was actually... And there's still lots more. Anyway, it's very annoying. On other topics. So, where does your interest in these kinds of things come from?
I mean, I hate to be a cliche and say it's just a natural thing.
Mm-hmm.
Just
general curiosity.
Yeah. When I was in high school, I had a really good social studies teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, a history teacher. And I said, when I grow up, I want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like my whole life trajectory followed that, which is a common story from what I understand.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So after my army time and everything, I became a teacher, bounced from school to school in America. And then got my second degree in psychology. So I have a social studies and a psychology background, and I decided to start putting that out into YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
while I was looking for a quote real job.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And then YouTube became the real job.
Right.
So.
Right. Which is the dream and the nightmare.
yes, definitely one of those double-edged swords.
Yeah. How do you find doing it as a full-time thing? Is it the dream?
I mean, certainly. Compared to my previous life, it's definitely very nice, but it also comes with its own unique challenges.
Mm-hmm.
The negativity, of course, you get way more negative. Well, I don't know about you guys. I get I certainly see way more negative comments than I see the positive.
Yeah.
They are in there, of course, but I scroll right past them because
you don't need to sort of deal with them, right?
Yeah. I really like this. It's okay. Next, and then there's the person who breaks down every 30 seconds to tell me
what you said.
Most of the time, I can ignore it because it's just their rantings. But very occasionally, I do mess up something, and it does hurt a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, even when we have very nice, generally very nice commentators. We also have a much smaller channel, and so we don't have the volume, right? Like, and then our topics are not nearly as controversial, except for, you know, once or twice we've done, you know, the misogyny video was a little more.
Yes, I remember that one. Yes.
But even it did get troll, or it did get negative reaction, but, you know, not that bad, really. Like, I was braced for much worse, and we didn't get that bad. I only had a actually block a few, remove a few comments. And
I lost a few thousand subscribers from the feminism video,
and
I was really worried that I had shot myself in the foot a little bit, because the next video I lost a few more, even though the next video wasn't related to feminism. It was just
but it
like,
probably like surfaced the other one or something.
So the next like two or three I had lost, but now I'm on the rebound.
Right.
The men's rights video, for some reason, jumped me back up. It's like a lot of the numbers that I lost from the feminism video came back, which is very strange because the tone of those two videos is very different.
Mm.
They're related topic, but one of them is just, here are some facts, and the other one is, here are why all these people are kind of wrong.
Right, so that was one where you actually took a stance based more of
one. Yeah, that one was not a moderate's guide by any means. That one was, I've been getting a lot of feedback from my feminism videos, so now I'm going to look at the response,
Yeah, and so if people are coming because they're like, finally, he's talking about men's rights, if they actually watch the video, that should not be what came out. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, so we don't get the same kind of negativity, but even so, when we do, and we do make mistakes, and when, you know, and a lot of, like, we pronounce a lot of things wrong, right? Like, Mark, you do your darndest, but there's a lot of languages in the world.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we'll get somebody commenting, that's, you know, I'm Hungarian, and that's not how that word goes, and we're like... And I mean, they're not normally mean about it or anything, but you still feel a little like, I wish we could just change that, but of course you can't. And so, yeah, it's frustrating.
There's, I want to say in every video I've made, there's a sentence that's wrong.
Right.
Where I say, in the Dante video, for example, I say that Judas got 40 pieces of silver when he got 30 pieces. Yeah, yeah. But
it doesn't change anything, yeah. But yeah, you could change it.
It's not like, oh no, the video is completely wasted now. But yeah, it is one of those, like, every time I look through the comments,
yeah, somebody's saying it's 30, not 40.
And I still, to this day, I have no idea how it made it through. Mm-hmm. Like, I research it, I write it, I sent it to a theologian, I sent it to another creator. It made it through all those.
Yeah.
And it still ended up in the video.
Yeah.
What? How do you not have that happen if it went through all these people before?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. I mean, we care about things being right. It's bad when they're bad, but and it does. It gives that one thing for that one commenter who was just if they're not even being nasty, they're just kind of looking for a way to interact with the video. Oh, on the other hand, it gives you engagement.
Yeah. Right? That's true. I mean, comments are engagement.
Even if the comments are telling you you're wrong, they still YouTube is like, aha, engage.
If I have a pimple. Yeah. That's all it'll ever be. Yeah.
Wow.
Reasons to not do two camera stuff.
Yeah. I made all the way. Yeah.
So one of the more recent videos, you wore something different than you normally do.
The poet shirt?
Poet shirt. And there were like several comments on how good the shirt was. And I was like, okay. And they were all from like men. It's like, good. Good, that's good. That's the way you want it to be. It's floofy shirt. For the ones on poetry. Yeah. So, speaking of videos, and making videos, and the highs and lows of making videos, how has your EduCon and your VidCon been? Since that's why we're all here, this stuff?
Well, at this point, I don't get much out of the panels, where it's, here's how to... best practices for audio editing and lighting. Mm. At this point, I've got that, I think.
Or as much as you need for what you're doing, yeah.
So it's mostly just the networking that I enjoy and what I'm here for, is to get together with other creators, especially ones I haven't met before, just to kind of forge that bond a little bit. You never know. You never know when
something's going to come out of it.
That connection might be useful, yeah.
And it's sort of emotionally useful, if nothing else, yes. Right? Like, there's a lot of that.
Being able to speak to other people who do the same thing and at least understand, because I can talk to my dad all I want, but he doesn't.
Right.
It's like, well, just don't read them.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Well,
that's
yeah.
That's not how it works.
Yeah, that's what I found, certainly, at the end of last year. I felt both, on the one hand, kind of inspired seeing all these other great, meeting all these other great creators. But also it was great to have that kind of group commiseration about the, you know, the frustrations or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And just, as you say, just being able to like speak without explaining everything as you go along.
Yes.
Because it's such sort of recondite things that you have to care about, like view velocity or something. Like nobody else should have to care about that. Shouldn't have to know what those words mean or whatever it is. And it's just nice to be among people who are all
about the same things. Don't get to do this very often, once maybe twice a year, depending on where you live and whatnot, but when I do, I've become an extrovert for a weekend.
Right.
Where most of my life I stay indoors and just play with my ferrets and that's it. So it's nice to get out
because it's easier to be an extrovert with people who are on the same page with you.
Yeah.
Who like all you of don't have to explain yourself
extroverts.
To.
Yeah.
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 Some of us are kind of extroverts all the time. For better or for worse. But yeah, no, I agree. And, you know, bend the ear of a YouTube employee or two.
Yes. Yes, that's...
We'll see what comes of that.
Yeah, that's nice also. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that was the EduCon thing did let us spend some time
YouTube people. Yeah.
To YouTube's credit, they were willing to put themselves among us and let us
rant
at them.
On difficult topics, so they did have a panel that dealt with trust and safety. So,
yeah, whether it, you know, covers everything or gets anything done or changes anything. At least they were willing to talk about those things, and that's not by any means always true. So, yeah, we'll see what comes of it all. And feed us quite good food. The dinner. The dinner was good. The lunch was its own thing, but the dinner options were
pretty good.
And lots of free booze, so.
Yes. Also good. All right, well, I think we should wrap it up there. But remember, so that's Knowing Better, and I really do recommend that you go over and check out his videos. There's lots of stuff there that will appeal to you if you watch our videos and listen to our podcast. So thanks again for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Welcome, Corey, Jareth, thank you for being here.
Team 12 Tone.
Team 12 Tone, yes, exactly.
Thank you for having us.
So why don't you start off, Corey, do you want to just tell our listeners about your channel and what your videos are like?
Sure. So we do videos about music theory. The channel's 12 Tone, as Avon said. And we talk about popular music sometimes and like rock songs a lot of the time. And then also some of the more abstract theory. Like, it's more examining the underlying structures of mostly Western music, because that's the music that I know best and am most expert in. But just sort of looking at these different models for how to think about music at sort of an abstract academic level, instead of just, you know, listening to it and enjoying it, which, you know, we don't enjoy music. We're music theorists.
That's just like antithetical to the field.
Just,
that's
not what we do. It's not.
Some people
it's not
do.
Dignified.
No, I genuinely, that's somewhat true. I think Core talks a decent amount about how learning music theory has let them appreciate music at a deeper level, but it's also made it tougher to like enjoy certain styles.
So what it is sort of more that it becomes hard to enjoy it passively.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It becomes sort of. Like I mean, I don't know if you guys have the same experience with language, but just sort of, I mean, language is much more ubiquitous even than music. Yeah. It's kind of everywhere. But it just...
Well, stop talking. And even in music,
But just, like, wherever I'm, like, listening to, like, songs, it becomes a very active process where I'm sort of thinking about what's happening and thinking about, you know, how the chords are moving, how the arrangement is going, what the instrumentation is.
It's a lot harder for it to be background.
Yeah, and so when I want to sort of relax, I genuinely don't usually listen to music for fun. Mm-hmm. I mean, I enjoy music when I listen to it, but when I just want to, like, sit down and, like, zone out or just do a thing just to relax, I watch TV, I play video games, I read. Like, there's all sorts of other things that I'll do instead of listening to music because it is... It's, I think, a much more enriching and fulfilling experience.
But it takes work. It's effort.
It's effort, and it's my job, and sometimes... Actually, it's a fun anecdote. I used to do boxing training a long time ago. And my trainer was telling me, because I was talking with him about this, and he was telling me that he used to train a model, and that she would come in and she would do things, and she would never, like, smile or show, like, any sort of, like, emotion. And like he mentioned this to her and she was like, yeah, that's my work. Like, I don't want to be like making, like showing emotion on my, I don't want to be making facial expressions when it's not,
because she probably, because when she does, right, she thinks about it, right? She doesn't, we all just smile, but she probably thinks about,
like,
exactly how she's gonna smile, and
it's, it becomes a much more complicated process, and so it's easier to just not do it when you don't have to,
rather than try to find a relaxation,
like,
mode of way,
like,
to
how
do
I,
it.
Yeah, how do I make this look natural?
Just don't do it. That's interesting.
Well, I guess I'm a little bit like that when reading literature, like reading a novel or something. It's hard to not think about, you know, how the plot is structured or something.
Or the themes that are coming out or whatever. And while that can be, as you say, enriching. But it can mean that it's... See, I'm pretty good at turning my brain off on those things, but where it does hit me is, and this is pretty cliched, but like watching movies about the ancient world or whatever. Like, I can't turn off... I don't get upset about movies that are inaccurate, but I can't turn off the part of my brain that's like, what's going on there and how does this actually relate to and how can I teach this class?
Yeah.
You know, like that part And I like the fact that when we teach the film in the ancient world, for instance, I get a substantial number of students, and I'm sure you've had this too, who say at the end, well, thank you, you have ruined watching movies for me completely, because yeah. now I will never not see these narrative tropes, right. and I will never not see these, like, structural parts and the way that they leave these things out, and thank you. That is, like,
storytelling behind it.
Yeah, I'm so pleased to hear it. I feel like I've done my job.
Similar, like, whenever, like, stories involve music.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. I'm always listening. There's this... because I have a vocalist background. I'm a vocalist by training. Mm-hmm. And so there's this one episode of a show called Leverage. Mm-hmm. It's a great show. But there's the one episode where they're basically con artists doing good. That's the elevator pitch. But basically, one of the things that they have to do is they pretend one of the people is a country singer. And so the hacker of the team, like, goes in, like, breaks into the sound booth and sets it up to run everything through this, like, auto-tune algorithm thing so that, like, when he's singing live, it'll sound perfect. Hmm. And so he gets up there. He starts singing into the microphone, and then the team leader who's listening is hearing both feeds, and he's just like, hey, the auto-tune isn't working. It's the same output. And the hacker just looks at the thing and is like, nah, he just doesn't need it. It's like, no vocalist can sing so precisely. It's just not a thing.
If you've set the computer up to make it perfect pitch, that's coming in is not going to be that.
Because you're singing country, and country has twang, it has bends, it has slides. And your auto-tune is going to catch that.
Yeah.
So if he's singing country well, then it's definitely going to flatten that out.
It's just like, those sorts of things. It's like, I still enjoyed the episode. It's a good episode.
No, but
like,
you can't not notice it.
You can't, I can't just, like, suspend my disbelief that far because I know too much sometimes.
Yeah, exactly. It's the curse of knowledge.
Yeah.
Pop culture is basically ruined by knowledge.
My background's physics, and that's pretty similar to...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah. Well, watching sci-fi movies must be painful.
Although I will say, I really liked the new Star Trek when they, like, had red matter, and they're just like, this is red matter, it makes things into black holes, you can go to heck.
Yeah.
I prefer, my sci-fi bullshit via fiat rather than by an uncomfortable explanation.
They're sort of close to the truth, but then they bend a few things, and you're like, no. As opposed to... Hey, magic. Right,
exactly.
We're going to use a science word, but it's magic.
Space magic. Deal with
magic.
It.
Yeah.
These are wizards in spaceships. I don't know what you want from me.
Like, for every time, I like Discovery, but every time Star Trek briefly remembers there's no gravity in space and tries to, like, explain why gravity does work, you're like, no, don't. Just, like, just pretend.
Just look into the camera and say artificial gravity.
They have that bit where they turn off the artificial gravity and they float, and it was a cool scene and everything.
Yeah.
But also, it immediately makes me start thinking about, wait a minute.
Then
so how was it working? How do you... when they turn off...
Gravitational fields are hard to generate. Most of the ways people think to do that.
Magnets that pull on blood.
Blood magnets. Well-documented scientific phenomenon, blood magnets.
Turns out that's indistinguishable.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I learned that from X-Men.
That's right, Magneto. Yeah, you can do it.
It's pretty cool.
Anyway, yes.
Sorry, I didn't mean to.
No, that's exactly...
Sidetracks.
Do you ever get, like, comments from viewers who say, thanks, you ruined that song for me, or something like that?
Well, often... I do get a lot of sort of not usually thanks. but no, there's a lot of people who will tend to view music theory as destructive to the artistic process and to the enjoyment of music. I think a lot of that comes from this misunderstanding that music theory is an attempt to be objective and to sort of understand and explain music in a way that is universally applicable.
Right.
And that therefore, if I say that this works because of this, and you aren't thinking of that, then that feels wrong, even though, like, I make mistakes. Mm-hmm. But, like, a lot of it is sort of subjective enough that most of the time I'm right, just because even if someone else is also right and saying something different.
Mm-hmm.
But I do get people who will try and argue that trying to deconstruct ruins the music, or...
Mm-hmm.
Makes it less enjoyable, and that therefore... Oh, one thing I get a lot is people arguing that, like, because I title my videos Understanding Song Name, like Understanding Comfortably Numb, Understanding Black Hole Sun, these sorts of things, and then I'll get people who come in and be like, well, the only way to understand this song is to get really high, and it's like, no, I... I have a different way. I have a, not necessarily better, depending on your goals, but sure. I have another way.
High on music theory.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's, kids, it's the best high. Yeah.
It's not. This is not
third best.
The views of the guests do not necessarily reflect the views.
Exactly.
Actually, they probably do.
Yeah. But yeah, no, it's definitely... There's definitely pushback. I think that there's not... I think most people who appreciate music theory appreciate that it does give them a better experience and a better understanding and a more rewarding and fulfilling experience of listening to music if you have those structures, if you're aware of those structures, if you know what's going on. But I think that there's also a significant pushback to the idea that the field exists in the first place.
And the people who come to your understanding videos are often brought to them. You know, those, your subscribers are not going to be saying, how dare you analyze a song, because that's the point of the channel.
Yeah.
But somebody who comes to it because they like the song and are going to...
And that's
part
of like
say, may not
it
like...
is. It is a somewhat ambiguous title, somewhat intentionally too. And so people do sometimes come expecting a lyrical analysis, especially on songs that are more ambiguous, like Black Hole Sun, where you get
they're hoping they'll explain what it means.
What is this song about? And it's like, well, it's about the chords. It's got some cool
snakes.
Chords. Snakes. It's about snakes. But no, there's a lot of interesting stuff. But it's you definitely get a lot of people coming in and be like, I thought you were going to explain the lyrics, and like sometimes. That's, you know, that's angry, and it's like, why didn't you explain the lyrics? And it's because you can just read the lyrics. They're out there. You can figure
and
out
there's
yourself.
There's actually, like, an entire site. I was going to say, there's an entire site devoted
genius,
to that. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And
that
for a lot of these, there are other,
other
channels, too, that will do similar like things, but talk more about the story and the lyrics. And so, like, that information is out there. What I'm trying to do is something different. But I also do get people who come in. I was like, I thought this was a lyrical analysis. I never knew that you could do something like this, and this is super cool. And so that's mainly why I keep doing that title, is just because I think that it draws in people who otherwise might not have known that this was interesting to them.
Yeah, for sure.
Which is, of course, all of our goals.
Because if you're only... I mean, we love talking to people who know that they're already interested in it, but if you're only ever talking to people who already know that they're interested in it, then there's
I love getting feedback from music theorists, but music theorists can do their own analysis.
Yeah.
It's not...
And I know that I know from your comments on Twitter and some of the comments I've seen on your videos that the other sort of pushback you get is the, well, the person writing this song didn't know all this theory, and therefore it can't be real.
You're wrong.
And that's, I think, as
a literature person, I am very aware of that particular argument, right?
This whole thing where, like, especially because what music theory is trying to do is examine the underlying structures of a musical culture, and those are largely absorbed through osmosis.
Mm-hmm.
So one
they
of the things,
unconscious
like,
to
yeah,
a large extent.
Like I did a Nirvana video, and people were dropping in, and it's just like, oh, well, Kurt Cobain didn't think that he was using secondary dominance or like encircling.
He doesn't know what those
think,
words mean, therefore it isn't true.
I don't remember that there were secondary dominance in that song. I just picked a fancy theory term, but they were just like, he didn't think about it in these terms. I was like, yeah, but he spent a long time, like, learning to play Jimi Hendrix and learning to play, like, his other, like, his favorite guitarists and all that stuff. And so what sounds good to him on a guitar is informed by what the people he listened to did.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because that's a lot of how we build our models, like, internally of what we enjoy is based on what we experience. And so we can compare these things to, like, oh, this sounds like this other song I like, so I like it. And part of that, we can ascribe like an overly essentialist view of that is like, these are the things I like, and I like these set of songs because I have it. But really a lot of it is that sort of comparison back and be like, oh, well, I enjoyed this Pink Floyd record. I'm going to go look for other sort of stuff in that vein. And then sort of maybe you drift over to like King Crimson, right? But the Pink Floyd has done so many different kinds of things. It's hard to pick a band that sounds like Pink Floyd.
No, but it's even more basic than that, right? The lullabies you heard set your scale expectations for the rest of your life and things like that.
Those were written by
and those came out of a context.
Yeah.
And those, I mean, and this because that argument and I know that these are arguments about aesthetics that are had in various philosophical ways. Like, are there essential components to aesthetics, or are they all culturally developed? And learned, and you can have those arguments, but I don't think anybody argues that they're not substantially culturally formed, right?
Like, even if there are some... certainly people who will argue that is the thing.
But I think within the discipline, there's sort of a
kind of a thing with music theory where sort of at the very bottom of music theory, it's all built on math. Mm-hmm. It's all built on like tonal, like frequency ratios and all that.
Yeah, ratios between
and so like
and things,
people,
yeah.
like especially sort of in the Western tradition, especially in the 19th century, sort of went back and so we're making a lot of these very like rigorous arguments that like this is true.
Yes.
And this is what the math says are the best notes, and therefore they're the best notes. We'll play these like these are good, these are bad. Mm-hmm. This is.
These ratios are good, these ratios are bad. Yeah,
and so much of it, and you do see a lot of these sorts of ideas pop up across cultures, like octaves. The perfect fifth is very common. That's a 3-to-2 ratio of frequencies. And so, but you get these sort of that places like essentialist value that says, like, because the math says these are good, they're good. And it's like, well.
There's a real chicken and egg thing going on here.
A lot of that is like.
That math isn't happening in a vacuum.
Yeah, that math is done in a cultural context. And also, other cultures haven't valued it. Like, a lot of theory, like especially older theory, less so these, not these days, but less so these days, is sort of built on, like, the assumption that the Western canon is the best music. And so, like, you go
so
back...
all you're doing is just explaining how it's
and
the
so,
best
music.
Yeah,
you go, and, like, there's sort of the history of, like, Schenkerian analysis, which is, like, has been sort of adapted and modified these days to be less that. And there's certainly... I'm not going to disparage the modern use of Schenkerian analysis, but, like, historically...
I know.
It's just... It would be a lot of theorists would be mad at me if I did.
These disciplinary, like, things are important. You need to say these things.
It's a whole
thing. Yeah,
but,
like, feel about string theory.
Like, if you go exactly. back to, like, what, like, Schenker was doing, a lot of his motivation was based on the idea that, like the 19th century, like, white German male composers had somehow written the best possible music, and so he built a system to sort of analyze all music. Yeah, it's sort of a chicken and egg thing, where it's like, he's building the system that somehow happens to make these look the most beautiful and elegant, and then turns around and applies it to other music, and is like, well, look at how much less beautiful and elegant this is in this system that I built for the German masters.
Yes, this is not an unusual way the scholarship has been done, and I would say my entire field, for instance, suffers from it. We called it classics. So that's the first clue.
Yep.
But you know, like, if it, like, very much so, there's a, you know, the Iliad is the best work in the entire history of human writing.
I mean, it is.
Therefore, let us measure all other things by how well they match up to the Iliad, see that they do not match up to the Iliad, and therefore we have proven that they are worse.
Yeah,
and you know, and like, and then or the Aeneid. It's really, those are the only two choices. It's either the Iliad or the Aeneid, or here's the best work ever.
At least you have two. We have the German masters.
But you know, I mean, it gets worked to other further out too. But and it's an attractive thing, because you're like, but I love this work, so it must be the best, you know.
And it's
seriously
the whole question of canonization. It's just like, because it's not that. None of this is to say that these works aren't good.
No,
like,
the Aeneid are amazing.
Yeah, sure. Like, I'm not going to sit here and be like, Beethoven was a bad composer.
Yeah.
That's not the stance I'm taking here.
Though, if it is, you heard it here first.
Yeah, 12 donates Beethoven. It's on the record. Can't
I'm
take it back.
To take that stance. I'm not.
But no, the whole thing with canonization is that there's so many sort of cultural factors that play into who gets to be in the canon and whose music gets played enough to be considered classics, or whose books gets read, and whose books...
Who even got the chance to write the music, because they...
Especially in the case of stuff as far back as what you're working with, it's just like, what books happen to survive? Like, what pieces of paper made it this long?
What is there that we don't know about that was better?
Yeah, it's just like... Yeah, we never read the Iliad 2, Return of the Iliad.
That was the Odyssey.
I'm not going to do that, thank you.
Right. I take it back.
No, but there is genuinely a whole set. Yeah. It's called the Epic Cycle. It was the entire story of the Trojan War from beginning to end. And out of that, we have the Iliad and the Odyssey.
Yeah.
But like, there were epics about like the Golden Apples part of the story, and there were epics about the like other 10 years of the war.
Yeah.
For instance, like the actual fall of Troy isn't in the Iliad. That and there were epics, and they don't survive.
Wasn't that in the end of the Odyssey?
It is recounted in the Odyssey.
I've only read the Odyssey as such.
No, the Helen and Menelaus talk about it. And they're like, so yeah, that time when I kind of came and tried to trick you out of the horse. Yeah, but I didn't mean it. Now we're back together, isn't it great? But yeah,
I do appreciate that, like, the one or one of the two that we have just happens to start with it and be like, let me summarize the last book for you. Previously on the epic cycle.
And I suspect very strongly, I may not be alone in suspecting that there is, this is one of the reasons these are what survive, and like, this is, you know, and there's an argument. I'm only just going to say this because to my audience who are going to like, fuss if I don't say it, almost certainly the Iliad and the Odyssey were earlier than many of the other pieces of the epic cycle that have been lost, so it's probably that they've built those other poems, kind of got built to fill in the gaps. Probably, I mean, there's no certainty about any of this stuff, but probably.
It's like how Beethoven actually wrote his
Ninth Symphony first. Then it wasn't as good, because it wasn't the same, it didn't get passed down. We have summaries of them, but we don't have the works, because they were considered inferior. Yeah. And therefore they were discarded, so we don't have them.
Really
and
need them,
what inferior means is they weren't the same as the Iliad and the Odyssey.
Yeah.
So, you know, from that far back, we've been, like, abandoning stuff because it didn't match up to what we've already decided is best.
Yeah.
And that's the frustrating part of canonization.
Yeah, especially because, like, a lot of the older stuff literally just get destroyed.
Yeah, and then we lose it.
We don't have, like, easy digitization. Mm-hmm. I mean, digitization has its own set of problems with conservation, obviously. Mm-hmm. But, like, you know, you can go back, like, 10 years and look at most of the music that was made and most of the books that were written, even if no one cares about them.
Yeah,
and
even if they aren't the best.
That long. But, yeah, it's just, like, you have this better, and it's even, like, once you get, like, to the printing press and whatever, like, it becomes much easier to preserve a book. Mm-hmm. And so, and similarly, sort of with music, like, as music notation got better, it became easier and easier for us to, like, hold on to a song that someone wrote.
Because, even if it wasn't considered the best of the songs.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, so some manuscripts are going to get discarded or burned or, like, used for whatever, but, like, you have this better record of what people were doing once notation got better, once writing got, like, education got to the point
paper
where most
got
people
cheaper,
could do it.
All those
paper
things,
got cheaper, ink got more, you know, it's just, like, accessible. All these things that just become easier to store knowledge long term. And so if we go back and be like, what was the best song of the 5th century? We have no idea. Like, even if we knew how to quantify that, like, we can only sort of guess at what that music sounded like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, and it is so frustrating to go back to those periods and hear the stories, because people talk about the great singers and the beautiful music and they discuss it, and you're like, and that sounded like what? Sweet.
Yeah.
Thank you. It sounded sweet. That's very helpful.
Yeah.
Would you like to explain how many intervals you're like
what were the notes here?
We don't even know if it's monody or if it's
like we know that there's like this big, like, in sort of Greek culture, like, differentiation between, like, stringed instruments versus wind instruments culturally.
Yeah.
And so we can sort of guess from sort of recreating those instruments sort of what that might have, but we can only again speculate about what the music sounded like.
And all the
scales they were using.
We did this past week. We had a guest video from an expert on ancient Rome
Andrew Mark Henry.
Who was kind of
Mark.
Recounting. Who was recounting, like, we could kind of recreate some of the our later Roman Christian chant music.
Christianized Roman chant, and
which can indicate perhaps to us something of what it came out of, and, like, give us some
suggestions. There's some spots.
We have some, like, broad histories of how these sorts of music developed.
Mm-hmm.
But
the idea of being
the idea, like going back and being
like,
well, were you singing like an E or an E flat here? Was this like a and it's just
what,
like, I don't know.
Sound
like even things like one of the things I wonder about is vocal quality.
Yeah,
right?
Because like that is something that is so
different
across cultures.
Across, like, recorded music, which is not that long a history.
Yeah, and also across cultures right now, like what is considered the most beautiful sound your voice can create in
Indian music, yeah, or Chinese music, or Western
even within
music.
Western music, you
like
know,
opera,
country versus
pop. Yeah,
popular.
Even within like Western popular music of the last couple
yeah,
decades,
yeah,
there's
yeah,
a huge variety in sort of
what
like
we
you,
like
yeah,
or what we think is interesting. So when
like
somebody says that he was a beautiful, you know, a Roman, mm-hmm, you know, singer was a beautiful singer, had a beautiful voice.
Yeah.
You know, in my okay, head, I'm hearing like an aria from opera, maybe,
yeah,
but.
Yeah, but it's like...
Is it?
Could
I mean,
be,
you, yeah,
could be, you know, it's totally different.
Yeah,
and
if
then
you compare, like, Mariah Carey to Britney
yeah,
Spears.
Yeah.
Like, that's just... That's
those
not
are
even...
Not, yeah,
yeah.
Or, and then you go, you know, Leonard... People say Leonard Cohen has a beautiful voice, which
yeah,
is a weird stretch. But,
yeah,
but
Leonard
like,
Cohen to Freddie Mercury.
Yeah,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
And so that, like that's one of the things, because at least musical instruments, you can kind of recreate them a little
yeah,
bit and then be like, okay, if
yeah,
this is what the material was built out of and this is what it
yeah,
looked like,
it's based on
something around
process,
this is going to be what the sound
like
is
going to
be.
Old physical things to
yeah,
model it off of.
But
like
the
was,
voice, you can do so
yeah,
much with
yeah,
it.
We,
but we
don't know
no
what
idea,
you get, because we know roughly what the anatomy was. We know what the mechanism for
but we
there's
can do
so much you can
with
do.
It. Yeah.
There's so much
yeah,
flexibility in terms of the tones you can create with your voice that we can only speculate
yeah,
what
the,
like these different things. As
and
far as
term,
I know, I mean,
yeah,
if anyone listening to this is aware of like actual scholarly research that has any sort of
yeah,
objective information on this, or like guess at a like reasonable estimation
yeah,
of an objective information,
yeah, let us know.
Please send me an email. I want to read that paper.
Yeah, because I would imagine like there's a few qualities, like if some you know nasal is a
yeah,
you know anything that sort of suggests that it has something to do. We could probably
yeah,
say that because I know that we've I know there are people to talk about like speakers as being particularly nasal and things
yeah,
like that.
Mm-hmm.
So there are people who
oh,
do
sure,
comment on that stuff from
yeah,
the ancient world.
Yeah.
But like that's only gonna get
that's,
like
yeah,
it'll give
yeah,
you a
yeah,
couple
there's
of hints here
as,
and there.
As someone with a vocalist background,
yeah,
there's a
thinking,
lot of different kinds of nasal.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
exactly.
It's a lot of different closed and openness that you can do. It
yeah,
can be really cut off and right up in your nose. It can be sort of just a brighter resonance.
It can be
resonance
nasal resonant,
thing.
Yeah, yeah.
There's just so much that
yeah,
you can mean by the term nasal when you're talking about a singer.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, that's one of the more precise terms we have.
Yeah,
right?
And that's, yeah, that's
so,
close to what we're going to get. So, anyway.
Yeah.
Just an all interesting
and of course,
stuff.
Nasally even then has gone through a few rounds of translation to get to that.
Yeah,
yeah.
So it literally is probably just going to mean associated
nosy,
with the nose.
Yeah.
Yes.
So
something
what does
in,
that mean?
Yeah.
Nose-esque.
Yeah.
Well, I will say that Shankarian analysis was one of the courses that I was about to take before I didn't finish my music degree. So I guess I didn't miss much. I don't
well,
know.
I think modern... I'm not
that
an
was,
expert
that was
in...
20, 30
yeah,
years ago,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
like,
well,
what they were teaching
yeah,
then is going to be different.
I am not an expert in Shankarian analysis. I want to be just totally clear on that. But for anyone listening, that's not sort of my primary focus. But it is my understanding is that modern Shankarian analysis has sort of separated itself a lot from those initial goals. And it's sort of... A lot of it's sort of... The argument is that it works despite that, not because of it,
okay,
and that's the general view, as far as I know. It still sort of assumes that all music is fundamentally counterpoint,
mm-hmm,
like that is the basic assumption. Which and there's most of the Western tradition is built on counterpoint, and the stuff we do today, counterpoint is a specific compositional style. I don't know that it's worth going into the details
no,
here, but just mm-hmm, it's the sort of thing that you associate with like Baroque music or.
Mm-hmm.
You know, basically most of the, like, especially the earlier classical composers you think of, like Bach, writing in counterpoint. But just like, it's everything that we do today is sort of built on top of that with other influences,
mm-hmm,
and has also in its own evolution as well. And so applying those models isn't meaningless, and there is definitely value that you can get out of Shankarian analysis, but it does sort of make some assumptions. About what the foundation of the music is that may or may not be accurate depending on what music you're looking at.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Which is true of basically every model
yeah,
of analysis.
Right.
That's not a criticism of Shankarian analysis.
Yeah, that's,
I
mean,
that's
yeah,
that's
how
models
I
work,
how I,
especially
yeah, right,
in a subjective field like music theory.
Yeah, that's how I think of,
yeah,
of like literary theory.
Yeah.
Basically, in order to develop a literary theory, I think you have to be wedded to it as the one true theory. Like the
yeah,
people who develop
yeah,
them have to be
yeah,
like
this
has
explained,
it's
everything,
unlocked the world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they create the theory. But I think for everybody except that creator,
yeah,
The value of theory is always lies in its applicability as far as it's
mm-hmm,
applicable.
Yeah.
And then the next
yeah,
theory
you can have
is
different
helpful,
tools
so the
in your toolkit.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, exactly. Value the predictive value.
You,
yeah.
I was about to use that exact
yeah,
analogy.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
Well, you know,
that's yeah,
like a...
yeah.
So, moving on.
Can we from that?
How can we ever top it? All right. No, yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Music theory and literary analysis and things like that, they are functionally very similar in terms of the kinds of things you're doing.
Yeah.
Even if the details are obviously
the structures
different.
You're working with are obviously very different, but sort of the ideas of this sort of cultural lineage that these models tend to have, and the things are built on previous ideas, and that you can sort of trace those ideas and apply them in new contexts because they continue to apply.
Yeah, and that you don't, you know, at least we would both argue, I think, that you don't need to worry about intentionality, because what you want to know is the effect. Like, what is what is the result, not a...
Absolutely. Like, one of my sort of favorite sort of music theory models, one of my favorite systems, is transformational theory, or neo-Riemannian theory, and that was sort of really, as far as I know, developed in the 90s, but it was developed to explain primarily, initially, the music of the late Romantic period.
Right.
And especially the late, also some of the early Romantic, but these things that weren't really following functional harmony models and sort of our older models, but still seem to have some sort of cohesion.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can go back and we can be pretty confident, and not completely confident, but we can assume that the composers weren't thinking about it in these terms.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like they may have been thinking about some of the ideas about like keeping common tones or whatever, but like they weren't sort of sitting down and be like, now I'm going to do a parallel transformation, because that terminology literally didn't exist, as far as I know, until the 90s, and the 80s maybe. I think it started in the late 80s, came into the 90s. I'm not entirely sure. I'm sort of basing that on reading the on Audacious Euphony by Richard Cohn, I believe.
Yeah.
But anyway, that was sort of how he described it. In my memory, I might have gotten some of the dates wrong.
It's all right. We won't hold you to it,
yeah,
I promise.
I just...
If you
someone
want to know
listening,
for sure, look it up.
Someone listening will have read the intro to Audacious Euphony and will know the exact passage I'm talking about and will be able to tell me if I got the date wrong. I just.
Yeah,
but
even though they didn't know the terminology
things.
Themselves,
yeah.
That doesn't mean that those things aren't in the music.
It's a very useful model, and I found it sort of basically once you step outside of stuff that you can really analyze with functional harmony, which is sort of the really traditional model that, like, from the 19th century, like, and sort of what. The stuff we do today, I tend to think a lot of it you can still analyze with that model as long as you're flexible.
Mm-hmm.
But sort of once you get outside that, like when I did my Aqualung video, the intro to Aqualung, some people argue it's in G minor, I argue it's atonal, because I'm right. But like the whole thing has so many different chords that don't really make sense in any key together.
Mm.
And so it's like turn it was like, what if we looked at this as a transformational thing? What if we started, and it's just like, all of it makes a lot more sense,
right?
Because a lot of the stuff we listen to today is still built on that.
Mm-hmm.
At its heart,
the Romantic period has, in every field, I think, a huge amount of lingering influence.
Yeah.
In fact, on the way we think of like aesthetics in general, like what sounds good, what we
for
do,
sure.
what we think. Yeah, and so it doesn't matter if somebody writing it doesn't know that they're influenced by it.
Yeah.
It's
think it's always worth being clear that like. You can also make stuff that sounds great and beautiful and awesome that is completely not influenced by the Romantic period of European art. Like that is
it's just that it keeps happening because we're all in, or not, but those people are in this context.
Yeah,
yeah,
a lot of it.
Academia
Academia is really built around it, and then like a lot of like the art, like the models of art have sort of survived and evolved and adapted.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, especially like modern popular music has a lot of African influence as well. Especially in the rhythms, just because it's, you know, a lot of it was made by African Americans. Rock music, the blues, jazz, all of these were styles invented by African Americans, and then eventually, you know, let's say borrowed by white people.
So, just because we will need to wrap it up because we need to go off to do more VidCon stuff.
Yeah, gotta go get lunch.
And lunch. Definitely lunch.
Lunch is important.
Well thought of.
Eat lunch most days.
Yes. I didn't yesterday, so today definitely aiming for that.
Gotta have a lunch.
How, just on that note of VidCon, how has EduCon and VidCon been for you in general?
Yeah.
Have you enjoyed it? What's been
EduCon was great. I think we talked about this, and I think I've talked with a lot of people about this, that like the actual logistical side, I felt like YouTube kind of tried to do something too big but didn't put enough like effort towards it, and so it kind of a lot of it felt sort of haphazard, but the actual like if you just didn't do much of the scheduled stuff and just hung out with people, which is, I think, a better way to do a lot of these conferences anyway. What I like, really liked about like EduCon and VidCon is also just seeing, you know, friends of mine who might not, it's not even necessarily about like seeing like those giant creators that, that's awesome to sort of get to interact with them as people. Just like seeing you guys, seeing like Allie and Micah from Neurotransmissions, seeing like all of like, think Betty, Cheryl, and seeing like Tristan and so many people that have like know online and have like a lot of you have met before at this point because we keep coming back to these things. But it's just like being able to sort of be in the same space as like my internet friends is a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think that's the real value of something like EduCon is the people. Having this group of people together. And so whatever you do with them, you've already achieved that that goal.
Yeah, I think the big thing is the best way to do it is to just stay out of the way as much as you can. Like I think the main sort of main day EduCon programming did that pretty well. Like it had the breakout sessions. But, like, you weren't required to go to them, and, like, you didn't have to do anything. You could just sit around in the hallway and talk to people, and that's what we did mostly. But then you could go to these things if you wanted to talk to people about a thing. Yeah. But, again, I enjoyed a lot of EduCon. And I also, like, very specifically, just in case she's listening, Jacqueline, you did awesome.
Yes.
Like, every problem I have with EduCon, I'm blaming entirely on you two.
Yeah.
Like, this is not...
No, none of this would exist without Jacqueline.
Yeah, without Jacqueline.
And also, this year would have existed in a very different form had Jacqueline not been involved, right?
Yeah.
Like,
she,
whatever was good about it, I basically credit her for everything good
about EduCon, I'm crediting to Jacqueline.
Yeah, I mean, like, she's been putting it together year after year.
Yeah, such an important figure in the community.
Yeah.
And
this is our
so much great work.
We create EDU benevolent dictator for life.
I don't want Jacqueline to think this is us blaming her for anything.
For me anyway, it's not even really complaining about it at all. It's just it's hard not to sort of look at it and
just,
see the things that where there were things that could be a little bit better or whatever.
We're people who analyze things.
And
there's another month.
It's just like stuff to maybe like keep in mind for next year, which and sort of. And if they,
forward,
which hopefully
yeah.
they do it again. I like
it's oh yeah.
I think YouTube is going to keep doing EduCon.
Yeah.
I think exactly what the form is and to what degree we're involved and all of that is all a little up in the air. I think they are 110% on board with EduCon.
I mean, as long as I think Malik stays involved.
I definitely trust Malik with a lot of this stuff too.
Very authentic
in his passion for education. So Malik is the head of the YouTube learning team again for. Anyone listening who doesn't spend all their time thinking about the people in charge of YouTube.
Yeah,
like we all know who Malik Dekard is, and like most of our friends do.
It took at least a year being in WCE and hearing his name being mentioned before I finally figured out who the heck he was.
Yeah.
Because you know all these names get thrown around.
Oh yes, this is the worst person. Corey would be like talking, tell him this, you know, Jim. Just please give me a channel name.
Yeah.
I don't know these people as like.
Of course I do, but it's way easier to think of.
So many different Patricks who have channels now. So I'll just be like, so I was talking to Patrick. It's like, okay, Tirzu, Patrick Willems, name explained. It's just like...
My old D&D group had three mics in it, and it's like that all over again.
More and more, I say more and more, but really as much as possible, what creators are usually looking for in these sorts of like, let's get a bunch of creators together type events...
Is to talk to other creators.
Often in these sorts of unstructured ways, and that's that's hard for a thing at VidCon size to do with people who have large channels. Like John Green can't just like come out, sit down, and be like, "Let's chat."
No, exactly. Because
that's
a security threat, and that's what EduCon has provided, and that's great glory for it. But therefore, because it's such a precious time, it would be nice if we had could expand that informal conversation level even a little more.
It would also be really nice if it was more time, you know?
Yeah.
Like if they were just like, "What if we just did 2 full days?" I'd be like, "I'm in. I'm there."
Yeah,
like,
they were doing.
They kind of expanded it this time.
Yeah, they did the thing, but then they interrupted it.
And they had the workshops during the day. Which still would have allowed for some informal conversation for people.
But that wasn't sort of broadcast as a thing that people should show up for unless they wanted to learn about lighting.
In fact, they were specifically capped. They had a certain number of people who could do it.
The whole thing with that is just it felt like it would be really nice to just sort of have more time. Like, in ThinkerCon,
I want my summer camp to go longer.
Yeah, exactly.
It is very summer camp.
It is,
I have a lot of people who are there described ThinkerCon was just
summer camp
for educational creators, which is great.
Yeah, so
it's a goal.
All right, I think we should wrap up because speaking of talking time, networking starts in like 50 minutes. So I've got to run and do that.
Probably got to eat too.
Yeah, I got to eat. Got the lunch. Thank you so much for joining us. And again, it's 12 Tone. It's the team behind it. And you should go and learn all more than, as we've discussed, you want to know about music. Thanks for joining us.
Of course, thanks for having us.
Well, welcome, Tristan and Kelly. Thank you so much for taking part in this.
Team Step Back.
Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, very happy to be here.
All right, so Tristan, start off by telling us about your channel and who you are.
Sure. I'm Tristan Johnson from Step Back History, which can be found at stepbackhistory.com. It's kind of my joke at this point. So I am a history PhD dropout. Who runs
proud title that
proud PhD
genuinely
dropout.
Is a proud title.
I was ABD, which I think most people can remember. You can't spell work-life balance without ABD. So I run a YouTube channel called Step Back History, which is about the past in general. When I started, there was only like 4 history channels, and none were not about wars and maps and conquest or memorizing a long list of people's families and who was their cousin, uncle, and who was someone's so-and-so. And so I made Step Back as a channel to be a place where all of the history that, like, all historians are doing these days could actually be talked about. Because all the stuff they were doing was stuff that, like, most historians have lost interest in, like, decades ago.
Mm-hmm. All the great man history and the,
precisely.
Refighting battles and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And Kelly, what's your role?
Yeah, I see myself as the manager, production assistant extraordinaire. I'm looking forward to getting more involved, hopefully, and moving forward.
We understand this production team.
Yes.
We understand that there are many reasons that we feel kinship with you, and one of them would be that. That particular relationship. Tristan and Kelly are also living in Toronto. Was that? Yes, that's obvious from your videos, right?
The downest town of Toronto,
are living in Toronto. And as a fellow Canadian and adopted Canadian, that's another link that we feel with you.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice to have some creators who don't automatically default to assuming everything is U.S.
It's true. We have a yearly tradition of running into each other at the airport on the way to VidCon.
That's true. At the gate.
Mm-hmm.
Even when flying from both times, different cities.
Yeah.
That's so strange.
Everything goes through Toronto.
That's true. That's why we like living there.
Yeah, it does make it easier. Obviously, the connection between your channel and the fact that you were doing a degree in history gives some is an explanation for why you were doing history when you started your channel. Why did you go into history as a degree? Where does your interest come from?
That actually is a funny kind of fugue state almost story. So most of my childhood, my parents are like huge road trip people.
Mm-hmm.
So I've actually, at this point, been to 7 provinces and 45 states.
Wow.
It's pretty impressive.
Some very technically. Like, I remember
through them, yeah.
Trust me, I don't think I remember anything from going to Idaho. And I think Texas, we just dipped into the panhandle once to take lunch so that we could say we did
you've
it.
Done it right now.
But for the most part, that was a thing in my life. But then teenagerdom happened and I became, and this will be funny for anybody who knows me in person or on video, I became a huge metalhead and a singer and a bass player. And so I thought I was going to become a record producer /
metal
singer or something. I think I was hoping I'd just become a record producer, you know, just the simple things.
Yeah.
And then I did a year of that. And it cost all of the money mom and dad had set aside for me to go to university. And then I failed horribly to the point where my final project, the teachers laughed at it.
Oh, dear.
And they said, this is so bad, we'll actually let you redo the project without paying the tuition for it. Yeah. But that was a good sign that this was not where Tristan belonged. So I had to push the reset button on my life with no saved up nest egg for mom and dad and just been like, oh, I get to do what every other millennial does, go into massive amounts of debt.
Another proud tradition.
Yep. And I got a 51% or D- average in high school. So I had to go through a whole program designed for people like me who had done poorly in school and wanted to go to university. then when I finished that at a certain GPA, you could choose what program you wanted to go into at one of two universities, York or Bishop's.
Right.
One, a well-reputable school with a legendary history department, and one, a university that is for the people who quote-unquote couldn't get into McGill or Concordia. That is like 2 hours out of Montreal, and I locked on, hey, that's 2 hours out of Montreal, which is far away from mom and dad. I'm going to go to that one. And when I had applied for my major, I was like set, and this is like just to show how like YouTube history might have changed, I was 100% set that I was going to go and do a degree in sociology. Then I just happened, the Christmas break that I was applying to universities, I happened to be listening to Hardcore History, the Dan Carlin show. And I think the one that hit me the hardest was on the Black Death. And specifically on like interesting ways of looking at it, and about how people at the time, if you think about them in the period and how they made all these connections about the end of the world and how the Revelation stuff, and that putting your mind in the head of somebody in the far in the past really resonated with me. And I said, I'd like to do that. And especially because I had a long running interest in pre-Columbian Mesoamerica.
Right.
So I was like, I'm going to just go do that. So that's why I just clicked history on the drop-down menu instead of sociology. And the rest is history. There was one point where I had to switch up because to do Mesoamerica, I would have had to have learned Nahuatl, which is only taught in a few places, and also leave Bishop's and go to another university because it would have been an archaeology degree I was going for, not history.
Right.
But it was still fun. I got there in the end. Yes. I did two master's degrees, and then I did the comps for PhDs, which I think is enough of an accomplishment.
It's a big accomplishment, absolutely. And in terms of being able to do the YouTube channel, the part that you needed, right?
Yes.
The wide reading, the getting to grips with the sources and the historiography. The drilling down and doing the specialist stuff that you would have done in your dissertation
would not really have helped.
Would not help YouTube, that much in the YouTube, really. Yeah. In YouTube. So
the number one thing I think I learned in grad school was the how to read a book in about an hour and a half,
and still actually have something useful out of it.
Yeah.
And what's really ironic about it is that now Tristan uses his audio engineering skills all the time. Right.
Yeah.
So
that's true.
Yeah.
So it wasn't it feels like a dead end in the road, but it was in fact a useful detour.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting because I go through my life story and I think, wow, I was really collecting skills for a job that just didn't exist at the time. I was like, I kind of want to do something artistic, but something technical. Because I took photography in high school too.
Right.
So it's like, I know all this stuff about, I know a little bit about photography and a little bit about audio engineering and just enough to be competent, but not enough to be an expert in television or something. I was like, I wish there was just something you could do that was for amateurs at media, but also wanted to talk about stuff. Only there was some sort of place where you could put stuff on some sort of tube.
And it is funny to think that, it's not that that didn't exist. There might have been some other ways you could do that, but something that didn't exist at all and now is the center of so many industries and what we're doing right now, VidCon and things like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So did you go to YouTube kind of as your platform? Was that the first thing you thought of, or did you try other kinds of ways of getting your ideas out there? Did you do blogging or podcasting or other things like that?
I've done a bunch of new media projects. I swear I've had a blog at some point in my life that I can't remember. I think as all teenagers do now. I had some podcasts that were about unrelated things. I had a video gaming podcast when I was in grad school. I had worked on a radio show that interviewed grad students about their research.
Oh, right.
On CHRW, the London radio station over at Western. But YouTube, I got started in 2007.
Yeah, that's early.
Early on.
Yeah, when it was a vlogging platform. It was a place, it was basically a blog site, but with videos.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And capturing funny moments and the world around us.
Precisely. It was a completely different thing. Mm-hmm. And what happened was time moved on and on and on, and YouTube became moved in and out of a centerpiece in my life. But it was always just a thing I just did to goof off. It was never a thing I had high aspirations for. And then I started dating someone named Kelly.
Who's that?
Yeah. You have a type then, eh?
I always like to tell this story because when we first started dating, I didn't really watch YouTube. I would, you know, search for things if I needed to figure out how to do something, yeah. But I was not a YouTube connoisseur. And Tristan had a YouTube channel, and he didn't tell me right away. And when he first told me, I was like totally weirded out by it, and like, I don't know, just the whole idea kind of made me crazy. It was just bizarre. And it was a different kind of, I mean, he was kind of doing what he is now, but this was before Step Back. Mm-hmm. And it was very much him on his bed in his dorm room, like...
like, more or less reading out of, like encyclopedias about history.
And depending on when you were looking at the channel, it still had, like, his rants from his, like, hostile atheist days, and I was like... newly not religious, and I was like, I don't know about all this.
Yeah, it was bad. It was unintentional. It had no strategy. It was just like a place I put things on for 8 years. And then at one point, Kelly was just like I tried to be like, all right, I'm going to take this more seriously. I'm going to make a video every day. And Kelly was
every
like,
day.
This is not, no, please do not do thing. So I shut down the channel in like February of 2015, thinking I'm going to double down on my studies and be a good master's student or something. Then that summer, after I finished my MA, I was going into a PhD, and I knew that PhDs were a little bit more of a slow burn, mm-hmm. especially the first year, because it was just coursework. Just coursework. Just read 7 books this week and then come and have opinions about all of them. So I was like, all right, I'm going to restart a channel, and it was going to be like, I'm going to try to do something that's a little bit more intentional and serious. And like, we bought a book and we read through it. We,
I inserted myself in the process right at the very beginning. I have a minor in business. And so I've always been interested in marketing and branding. And so right away, you know, he was like, I have this idea for Step Back. And he had this like drawn up sort of mock up, like black and white SB logo. And I was like, okay, but what does that mean? So we really spent a lot of time going through this book. Basically, every day you get exercises like,
oh, yeah.
What is your value proposition? Who is your target audience? And we did that together. So I have been involved since the beginning, mm-hmm. because I think it's really fun to think about, you know, how are we gonna brand ourselves? How are we gonna market what we're doing?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What are the goals and how do we achieve them?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So over the
what a weird way of thinking about a YouTube channel. I don't know. Having goals and attempting to achieve them in a systematic way seems very strange, yeah, and I'm not really sure I can handle it.
Yeah. So in the summertime, in like August, we started doing that, and I started interviewing other YouTubers that were already doing it, and I got really lucky. I'm not gonna name any names, but I got to talk to a really huge YouTuber just as like a Skype talk to just be like, how do you make things? And this is like a big animated YouTube channel, and he just went, I just like draw things in like Google Sheets with like shapes. And I was just like, oh, I can do that. I think the thing that made me want to start the channel is it dawned on me that CGP Grey videos are literally just like, like exaggerate, like fancy slideshows.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, I could do that. And so I made my first video in like September of 2015.
Mm-hmm. And at that point, it was fully animated.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't make that change until my first VidCon when I realized that, like, oh, no one's going to know me if I don't have my face on things. And also, it makes things, like, 6 times longer to make.
Yeah, exactly. Animation is so slow compared to camera.
Yeah, so that's a long story. And now Step Back is just this week past its 52,000 subscribers. That's a weird way to say it. It's a normal way to say it. 52 kilo subscribers.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's very good. Yeah.
And there's a lot of this conference to come home and chew on when I get home to make things even fancier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, did you go to the same sessions or separate sessions?
Nope, we divide and conquer.
Yeah, just like you guys.
Yeah, we usually do. For EduCon, we did that.
Yeah.
For VidCon, I was like, whatever, we'll just go to networking.
Yeah, like Mark and I yelled at YouTube together. It was fun.
So do you go to more of the businessy ones?
Yeah, that's the plan. I mean, Tristan this year was, now that this is his full-time gig, he was a little bit more interested in going to some of the business ones. But typically that's my thing. I go to the how do we turn this into a career? Like, yeah. what do you do beyond
monetization strategies?
Exactly,
stuff.
Exactly. Yeah. And I have some ideas for when we go back in terms of putting things together and creating an umbrella sort of LLC, whatever the Canadian equivalent of an LLC is, and that
I think it's an LLC as well, a limited liability company. I don't know, but I'm sure the mechanics are different, but I think it's the same.
Yeah, so I'm going to start doing that in terms of trying to put all the finance stuff in one place instead of just having it scattered everywhere.
Separated a little bit from the personal stuff. Yeah, exactly. It's one of those things we haven't done yet. And, you know, we're not making much money, but we are making some and we're putting money out, and it's one of those things. That, so when you've done that, maybe I'll pick your brains about how it
works. By all means, yeah.
Once you've figured out how to do that in Canada, I will talk to you.
Yeah. When someone found out that we had somehow successfully filed Canadian taxes as YouTubers, like several people reached out to me and were like, how did you do that?
Yeah, I did that for him, and I just said he was a... He had a business. It was just a business. And I just said it was like, I don't remember which of the numbers, you know, that you have
to put
under.
Yeah, that's what we did last year, too.
Yeah, and I haven't actually incorporated him as a business. Like, there is no actual business. Mm-hmm. But I was just like, it's a home business. That's what it is.
And I think that's fine. I just think...
With the income that we were making, it's not a big deal. Mm-hmm. And the expenditure is not that big, but...
I'm going to do some reading. I have a consulting company with a few other colleagues, and this past year we registered as a business.
Right.
So I at least have a frame of reference now for how to do it.
Yeah.
And it isn't that hard, and it isn't... I think there's some benefits, so I need to dig into that a little bit more.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's an element of there's a large element of activism in your channel. Mm-hmm. And I think you quite rightly, you know, always point out that you can't be apolitical, right?
You can't talk about these topics.
You can't talk about
and have no
history
position
and
on
not
it.
Have a, you know, have a political position, and so it would be dishonest to not be upfront about that. And that's something that I've definitely felt. But I know you get pushback from that.
So there's a lot to say on that. I think that there's like a growing status in the world that makes people think that if something has an editorial position that I don't like, that means it's political. And when it has one that you do like, it doesn't have politics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I do think...
If I agree with it, it's not political. If I don't agree with it, it's political.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, like, people have, like, lived their entire lives in this kind of, like... Because I mean, you know me. I'm, like, a crazy radical person who will say that, like, the entire world is full of right-wing maniacs, and I don't understand how... they have souls, but like I'll just go on and be like, okay so like they've gone through their whole lives with like a lot of things, like, because I think what makes my channel get a lot of extra flack is that most people have seen stuff with editorial positions that lean on like inclusive liberalism and like inclusive and like or like even like soft conservatism, although it doesn't show up as much in media as you'd think, but it still does. But I am like unabashedly like a communist, an anarchist, like all of the things. I'm the Antifa monster everyone warns you about, and so my positions, my set of what is just like the normal things of right and wrong are fairly often at odds with what is part of the general consensus of what's good. And history especially is a field that from like K to 12 is explicitly, like, it's written in the syllabus, taught, like, a nation-building project. Like,
mm-hmm.
I think
mm-hmm.
The Quebec history curriculum, is actually described as creating patriotic citizens and good consumers. Mm. And so I do know that with my, just my sense of normal, because everybody's creation, everyone's, like, artistic expression is going to show the way they see the world one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So even if they don't intend to be making a political statement, you can still find elements of what someone's beliefs are through the work.
Mm-hmm.
So why not be open and honest about it? I mean,
yeah.
Yeah.
Because, like, I mean, in the beginning, I tried to be very neutral, and people still called me out on it, and so I thought it'd be at least more honest to at least put
say what
out
you
there.
Actually think,
yeah.
And then get yelled and called names for it.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of not saying what you think and still be called names for it.
Yeah. And especially because when I was starting on YouTube, especially in like history, but also in just like what was going on, like 2015 on YouTube, like the previous year was freaking Gamergate.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a rising and terrifying cottage industry of far right political pundits who have since seemed to have hit their high watermark. And there seems to be a lot more opposition these days, which is very nice. But that wasn't the case in 2015. Mm-hmm. And so to even have, even not explicitly saying a left-to-center voice on YouTube was to be marking yourself as a target. Mm-hmm. Like, I think I've most of the vitriol and the violence and death threats and stuff like that I've received kind of peaked actually around 2016. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of died down since then. Maybe it's because the algorithm's pushing them away from me now or something. But
this is an interesting tension we have even in our house, though. Mm. I mean, it's his channel primarily, so I try to influence it, but ultimately he's going to make the choice. But I've always been much more, we're both left. We agree on the end goal. We don't always, I think, agree on the methods to get there. Mm-hmm. And I'm very much more like, incremental change. Let's work together. Let's try to appeal to people with different opinions. And he's like hyperbole, and he's like fiery, and you know.
Yeah.
I think it's an interesting tension.
See no parallel to our lives. Not at all, Mark. There's just no.
I'd be all for the revolution, except for the violence part, but otherwise, burn it down.
Yeah, we'll get that into that a little bit later. I think that I might try to ease off the gas on that a little bit. I did in one of my most recent videos say to support your Antifa troops, which might have which you know has a little touch of the irony, but mm-hmm. No, I think that I'm going to try and pitch for a more wider audience and just be more happy face and just be the wider end of the sales funnel for a mm-hmm. bit.
Yeah, because it. Well, we don't have to have the full argument about like those ways and means, but there, you know, there is a preaching to the choir problem in any position. Like that's like quite apart from what you think the ways and means of change in the society are in terms of reaching people. You know, if you drive away people, then your own goals don't get met.
So and I always
but
try
it's
to...
a tension because if you're just too centrist or too pablum about it. To use a Canadian term, mm-hmm. you don't get the attention, you don't get the interest, you aren't saying anything, and anyway, what's the point of preaching to a wider audience if what you're preaching doesn't have any content or meaning, right? Like, mm-hmm. so that's a tension, that's an ongoing one.
But I also am starting to think that now, especially opposed to like when I started, we're getting to a point where the ideas, like the ones I have, if they were just a little better marketed, are actually...
might be useful.
Yeah, like, mm-hmm. is it a Martin Luther King line, or is it just, like, one of those things that people say Martin Luther King said, that there's no more powerful thing than an idea whose time has come? Mm-hmm. And I'm feeling like there's a new kind of politics that seems to just be bubbling up out of the woodwork now that I would definitely like to be a part of, and I think I need to just market it better to get it to be in there.
And I always think, like, for me, you know, the idea of Tristan's politics freaked me out at the beginning. I'm from the States. We didn't talk about unions.
We don't have that part of the spectrum.
No,
really.
No. Yeah. I thought liberal was as far left as you go, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so I was kind of freaked out by it. But for me, it was learning, this always sounds super cheesy, but like learning where Tristan's heart was. Mm-hmm. Like all of his radical politics come from a place of wanting to see people succeed and wanting to see fairness and equity. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes in his like hyperbolic rants, you miss that. And so I joke that I like to come along, especially to things like VidCon, and sort of be like show the softer side of Tristan. Right. I feel like I like soften the edges a little by hanging around with him, because otherwise he looks like a firebrand, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll take this. I'll accept this.
So, you know, these are all topics we could talk about for longer, and maybe sometime we'll have you back on and we'll talk like more in depth about some of the, you know, the content,
specific things.
That would be fun. But for the moment, maybe we'll just pivot to, if you want to talk about how the EduCon and VidCon experience has been, how have you been having a good time? We just talked a bit about already, you've seen panels and you've been looking and finding useful stuff. So how's it?
So this is the third VidCon we've been to. And so far, this one has been different. Mm-hmm. Very different. Mm-hmm. The first two, I think, like, I never walk away from VidCon without making some sort of big business connection of some kind. This time I don't think I've walked away with any new friends, but I feel like I've strengthened a lot of the relationships that I had before.
Right.
And I've learned a lot from this VidCon. not at really panels, but just talking to people and talking about how the sausage gets made, I feel like I've passed into some sort of threshold where I can talk to people and like now learn about the real business that happens and how this stuff actually gets made in a way that, I don't know, I felt like maybe I wasn't, I either wasn't ready for as a creator, because I just didn't understand that world before, or just because I've, you know, built those relationships up over the years.
Do you think this is because you're a more experienced creator now than you were in previous years, or is it because the nature of VidCon has changed, maybe because it's become more ViCon?
I think it has partially to do with EduCon being better at facilitating access between the big, like, corporate education YouTube blobs like Complexly and PBS and stuff, and bringing them towards us indie folks. So that's one thing, is just being able to make connections across those lines and starting to talk to people who work in those areas and finding more about how everything works under the hood. Mm-hmm. But then also, building on those, like VidCon this year, yeah, the ViCon takeover has been shown. Like, I don't want to complain too much, but the creator experience was not what it could be used to be.
No.
But I've also, like, made friends over this year who are much more successful than I am. And, like, we were just saying last night, where, like, we had issues with being able to get, like, I was, like, not famous enough to hang out with some of my friends that I wanted to go see.
Right.
Yeah. And I was just like, oh, this is really weird. And then, like, just that led to conversations with other people and, like, getting deeper and deeper. And it's just like, oh, my, this is a whole thing. You have to know people. Like, I think I've learned, if anything, like, the number one lesson I've taken away from VidCon this year is it actually pays to be politely annoying.
And just make the, like, push a little bit harder.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to be assertive, because if you just kind of act passively and just, like, not think that, like,
if you're just waiting for something to happen.
Yeah, waiting for something to happen is not going to be the thing to do. And so I'm learning that, like, for me to move forward, I'm going to need to actually start knocking on doors and hitting people up and doing all of those cold emails and stuff that everyone hates doing. You got to be the person who loves doing it.
Mm-hmm. Always willing to.
I think VidCon is, for me, it's so fun. It's so different. Like, day to day, I work in the public service. And so, I have this, you know, button up 9-to-5 office job. So for me, being able to come to VidCon and interact with creators, and it's just such a fun way to spend a week that's so different from my day-to-day life.
Yeah.
And I really enjoy it.
Yeah. And, like, it's California, which is also very different from Toronto.
Exactly.
Yeah. Spending a week in California in July is not, it's not an unfun experience. Yeah.
Although, actually, we all were saying, you know, it's weird, it was hotter in
Toronto and Ottawa.
Yeah. In Toronto and Ottawa because of the humidity.
Yeah, though I'll say that today I think it's evening out now. Yeah.
The last 2 days have been pretty hot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I just, like, enjoy, I think that VidCon itself, the panels and, like, the stuff it's in, it's okay. Like, the panels, like, I don't think I'm spoiling too much, like, the panels have limited.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It's very much, like, 101 stuff that.
Yeah.
And there's a certain limited repeatability to them. So once you've done the 1 year, if it's another one, even if it's different people on it, you might not
feel. And there were fewer creator sessions, fewer educational creator sessions.
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems like they're really trying to double down on the community work stuff. Mm-hmm. So
that's where the money is, where you can sell the Twix ball with Megan Trainor.
Does that cost money to go to?
I don't know. I hope I never have to find out. I never want to go to something called the Twix Ball.
No, it's Twix Prom, which is
Twix Prom. Even weirder.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, so, like, but honestly, like, coming here, just having everybody in one place for a few days is what makes it worth it. Mm-hmm. Even if you have to pay tickets to sit in a dark room with water. You just get to meet people, and you get to, and for, like, the more professional creators, people where this is, like, you know, there's, like, corporations, stuff like that, like, they spend the entire time having meetings and things like that.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to appreciate that as what VidCon is going to be the experience is like. And I'm hoping that if Step Back does better, that might be closer to my experience in the future.
Yeah, and start to think about, like, planning ahead of time, not just waiting till you hear and making the connections, but planning ahead of time, like, who's going to go to VidCon? Who am I going to see? Let's set up some meetings ahead of time. Even if they're just setting up coffee dates.
Yeah.
You know, like, maybe we're not at the corporate level of the meeting, but if it's just setting up coffee dates with specific people ahead of time, that might go somewhere. Like, that's a type of politely annoying. You know, not necessarily annoying, but sort of
pushing a little further. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that we're going to have to think about that kind of thing too when we keep coming, because just going and just sort of hanging out and waiting to see who's around, it doesn't always work. And also, as more of our friends become more big time, they aren't hanging around on the floor just waiting to do stuff, right? You guys are all doing stuff, so we need to start. I mean, we're not as big time as most people either, but like, not as big time as you, but if we want to sort of keep those contacts that we've now built, we're going to have to be a little more intentional about it, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because YouTube, but VidCon puts up some really strange velvet ropes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just like, you're just randomly not allowed in certain places. And like I said, like, it's sad that I spent like an hour being sad and mad that I wasn't famous enough to hang out with some of my friends. I was like, this is a weird
It's a weird place to be in your head. Yeah, yeah.
Like,
but...
man, if I just worked harder, I would have been more famous. And then I could do that. And it's like, oh my God.
I was like, Tristan, oh, you have such FOMO. And he's like, it's not even FOMO. It's actually Mo. I'm actually missing out.
So you got to be a self-advocate.
Think about it.
What about EduCon, though? I mean, that is, you know, that is a situation which doesn't have those kinds of divides between, you know, smaller creators and, you know, big network teams.
Yeah, that EduCon was amazing for that. The only thing a bad thing I have to say about EduCon is that it wasn't longer. Because, like, first of all, the breakout sessions they did in that were rock solid. I feel like I've learned something in every single one.
And the lighting session were both, they were over my head, but in a way that was so wonderful that I knew I was picking up enough little pieces that it was,
mm-hmm.
I was
learning to do things. Something with it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then, just the lunches and the two networking events were both really, really fun.
And I went to a diversity and inclusion panel that was good.
Right.
And then Tristan went to one about privacy and trust.
Yes.
Safety. So. That's where you and I yelled at you too for all the stuff they've been doing lately about hate speech.
Okay, that's good to know. Yeah. Cool. So thank you both for joining us. I think we'll wrap up there, but yeah, we'll catch you up another time too.
Thanks.
For
this was a blast.
And it was a lot of fun. And maybe next year at VidCon.
Yes.
Cool. Okay. Excellent. Thanks again. Remember that. Step Back History. Check it out.
StepBackHistory.com.
Oh, you beat me to it.
Bye bye.
For more information on this podcast, check out our website, www.alliterative.net, where you can find links to the videos, blog posts, sources, and credits, and all our contact info.
And please check out our Patreon, where you can pledge to support this show and our video project. You can go directly to the videos at youtube.com/alliterative.
Our email is on the website, but the easiest way to get in touch with us is Twitter. I'm at AvenSarah, AvenSarah.
And I'm at alliterative. To keep up with the podcast, subscribe on your favorite podcast app or to the feed on the website.
And if you've enjoyed it, consider leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. It helps us a lot. We'll be back soon with more musings about the connections around us. Thanks for listening.
Bye.